Vishnupadaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswate Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschati Deshitarine Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Jayapataka Swami Iti Namine Namacharya Padaya Nitaika Papadarine Gaura Kata Gramadaya Nagara Gramadarane Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadhadhara Siva Sadi Gaura Bhakta Brinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. Okay. Welcome everybody to the morning Bhagavatam class. Today's class, as was done about 2 months back, is also titled The Glories of Srimad Bhagavatam. And who all attended the class in January which I gave? Can you put your hands up? Okay. Thank you. So, now don't think that this is a trap. I just want you to recollect and tell us some points which you recollect from that class. Anybody? Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Any other point? Anybody else? Yeah, that's right. I mean, very high level of Sanskrit. Very good. It's nice that, yes, we've been able to recollect, because these sort of glories we have to embed in our heart. We have to be conscious of this, how glorious Srimad Bhagavatam is. For the benefit of everybody, I'll just summarize the bullet points which we discussed in the first class without going into any detail. And if anybody wants detail, after the class, I could be able to spare some time. One was the tightly composed language or structure. The other one was, the second point was the archaic vocabulary as well as the grammar. The third point was consistent philosophical content. This was emphasized by Srila Narada Muni to Vyasadeva. Because he said that in the Puranas you have, you know, Vaishnava emphasis in certain places, Shaivite emphasis in certain places, Tantric emphasis in certain places. He said, no. The Supreme Personality of Godhead has to be glorified on a continuous and consistent basis. This is the point emphasized by Narada Muni. Number four is the poetic nature, which Prabhu just now highlighted, just one of the points. We saw how, right from the first verse, Janmadi Yasya Yataha, and the Gopi Gitas, how nicely, poetically it is structured. And the last one was the manuscript history, where we saw how Bhagavatam, even Madhavacharya has commented that the verses of Bhagavatam could be corrupted. Corrupted in the sense, the meaning is okay. Kurus, Pandavas, war, etc., everything is okay. But when you get down into details, like how Kunti Maharani has been portrayed in Mahabharata, whereas how she has been portrayed in Bhagavatam. The manuscript history of Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam is literally etched in stone. So these are the points which we discussed in the first class. So those points which reflected how glorious Srimad Bhagavatam is, that class we did not discuss even one verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. We may have quoted Janmadi Asyata, Dharma Projitaka, all those kind of verses we may have quoted, but we did not discuss the meaning of any verse. So without discussing the meaning of any verse from Bhagavatam, we saw how glorious Srimad Bhagavatam was. Today's class will be exclusively from Srimad Bhagavatam, what Bhagavatam has to say about itself. Now as to why should it sort of self-advertise itself, I'll come to that a little later as to why it does that. So today's class is the glories of Srimad Bhagavatam, the spiritual contents. So in the first canto of Bhagavatam, it is said that after Krishna left this world, he took with him two things. Anything? Anybody can? Dharma and Jnana. 1.3.43 of Bhagavatam. Krishna swadhama pagate dharma jnana dibisaha kalau nastya drisham esha puranarko dunoditaha. So dharma and jnana, they left with Krishna. And Prabhupada writes in the purport to 1.3.43 that this Bhagavata Purana is as brilliant as the sun, and it has arisen just after the departure of Lord Krishna to his own abode, accompanied by religion, knowledge, etc. Then comes the telling point. Persons who have lost their vision due to the dense darkness of ignorance in the age of Kali shall get light from this Purana. So this is how glorious Srimad Bhagavatam is, especially for this age of Kali. Now, in the purport to this particular verse, Prabhupada makes another very emphatic statement. And since the statement is made by Prabhupada, none of us should take offense. Actually, it is not directed at devotees. It is directed at the other population. He says, in the Kali Yuga, the population is just a royal edition of the animals. Prabhupada is saying, they have nothing to do with spiritual knowledge or godly religious life. So this is how emphatic Prabhupada makes it as to how Kali Yuga is. Now, coming back to this dharma and jnana, which also departed with Krishna, once they departed and the onset of Kali, it left us in a very dark and bleak age. It left us literally blind without dharma and jnana. Now, if we remember, in Naimisharanya, what was happening? The sages who were assembled there, they were doing yajna for how long? 1,000 years. And what were they doing the yajna for? They were searching for a solution that Kali is coming, and how will the people of Kali be able to contend, that is, people who have been born in this age of Kali, how they will be able to contend with Kali Yuga. They did that yajna for 1,000 years. Their faces were black with soot. They did not get the answer. At the end of that period, they turned to Suta Goswami. Bhaiya, you have heard Bhagavatam from Sukadeva Goswami. Please tell us, how do we contend with Kali Yuga? So this is another background as to why Bhagavatam is very important, especially for this age of Kali. So in the verse 177, the first canto, 7th chapter, 7th verse, Prabhupada writes in the purport, simply by giving oral reception to this Vedic literature, the feeling for loving devotional service to Lord Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, sprouts up at once to extinguish the fire of lamentation, illusion, and fearfulness. Actually, you need not hunt for those verses. We'll be discussing just two verses in great detail, and that will be projected there, 112 and 113. I'll tell you when I come to that. But in the meantime, I'll just be referring to a few verses from Bhagavatam, just in passing, just to highlight what Prabhupada has to say, or what the verses have to say about Bhagavatam, and that will be in brief. So the Srimad Bhagavatam is the book form of incarnation of Krishna, and the unique thing about this incarnation is that this is a combination of all other forms of incarnation. Like for instance, when Krishna appears as Varaha, Matsya, Narasimha, etc., he appears in this material world, he performs his pastime, and then he departs back to his abode. He is not available here. We only have memories of those pastimes. Whereas Bhagavatam contains all of those pastimes and it stays with us. So that is another reason why Bhagavatam is glorious. We can participate in those pastimes irrespective of the number of times we hear, like Narasimhadev pastime. We may have heard it n number of times, but do we get tired of hearing that? No. So those pastimes are available within this book. So all the incarnations are present within this book form itself, and he stays here thanks to Srila Prabhupada. We saw this as to why we should be thankful to Srila Prabhupada at all points in time, because he has given us Bhagavatam with his word-for-word meaning, the translation, the purport, how nicely he has explained. And I explained that how one Panditji was reading Srimad Bhagavatam, just the Sanskrit slokas, without understanding one word. And I told you how he reacted at the end. You remember that? He said, Palla vadakkarudu, that is, it is breaking my teeth. What those Sanskrit sloka? Because he did not have word for word translation, meaning nothing. He just had the Sanskrit sloka. And yet he persisted, but he could not, I'm sure he could not get what is meaning. So herein lies the contribution of Srila Prabhupada, for which we should, all of us should be eternally grateful that he has made laddus on a golden platter. He has given it to each one of us. Baba, pakado, khao, or paroso. But whereas we seem to be interested only in the golden platter. It's a sad thing. That's so, it is emphasized that every day we should hear Srimad Bhagavatam. Now, initially, when Brahma gave the subject matter of the four Vedas through his four mouths, it was in a jumbled form. The mixture was separated by Vedavyas for the benefit of mankind, and he appointed his disciples as in charge of each of those four Vedas. A massive task. And in spite of doing this, he has written the Vedas, Itihasas, Puranas, etc., Upanishad, everything he had written. But he did not have the satisfaction. He found that there was some gap, which initially he was not able to understand, but then he got the realization that in spite of having done such a voluminous amount of work, that satisfaction of having done something concrete was still not present in his heart. And at that time, Narad Muni appeared on the scene, firstly, he chastised Vedavyasa. He said, what have you done? You have compiled all these literatures which are only telling humanity how they should be continuously engaged in performing the materialistic activities and enjoying that. You have not directed them towards the self-realization, the glorification of Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now in this connection, Narad Muni uses a very, very strong word, which we at our sadhaka levels, we should not use. But I will nevertheless recount this strong word which he has used, just one word to describe all what Vedavyasa has written up to that time. And he used the word called jugupsitam. Jugupsitam means horrible, abominable. I mean, we should not be condemning the Vedic literatures like that. But Narad Muni could do that just to drive home the point ki what you have done is not par for the course, is not beneficial for the humanity. You have glorified Supreme Personality of Godhead sometimes, but you have also put in other forms of worship. Sometimes you are saying there is no God. All these kinds of jumbled thing you have given. With the result, mankind will be confused. You have to write a literature in which the Supreme Personality of Godhead is glorified on a continuous basis. Or his disciples, how glorious his disciples are, that should be brought out. And that is beneficial for people who are contending with Kali Yuga. So here is another reason which has been brought out by Narad Muni as to why we should read Bhagavatam. That word jugupsitam comes in 1.5.15. Jugupsitam dharma krite nisasata svabhava raktasya mahan vyatikramaha yad vyakto dharma itartra stutho na manyate tasya nivaranam janaha. The people in general are naturally inclined to enjoy. This is a purport given by, translation given by Srila Prabhupada, and you have encouraged them in that way in the name of religion. This is verily condemned and is quite unreasonable. Because they are guided under your instructions, they will accept such activities in the name of religion and will hardly care for prohibitions. So this is how Narad Muni prodded Vedavyasa, ki what have you done? This has been translated by Srila Prabhupada. So he then nudged him to write a literature whereby the Supreme Personality of is glorified on a continuous basis in the book and not focus the attention of people in substandard religious things. We will come to that. What is that substandard religious thing? The point to be noted here is that Srimad Bhagavatam glorifies the Supreme Personality of Godhead on a continuous basis. This thereby will ensure that the mankind in general will be directed to also do so. That is, they will also glorify the Supreme Personality of Godhead on a continuous basis and attain the supreme destination. And the result of that nudge by Narad Muni to Vedavyasa was Srimad Bhagavatam. Now we shall see what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has to say about Bhagavatam. So today we will be discussing only about the glories of Bhagavatam, what various authorities have explained to us. Mahaprabhu says, and I'm sure all of you, or quite a lot of you must have heard about this verse, Aradhya Bhagavan Raje Satanyasta Dhamma Vrindavanam Ramya Kachit Upasana Vrajavadhu Vargena Yakalpite Srimad Bhagavatam Pramanam Amalam Prema Pum Arthu Mahan Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhur మతమిదం తత్ర నా పరహ. వాట్ డస్ దిస్ మీన్? వాట్ మహాప్రభు హెస్ బ్రాట్ అవుట్ ఇన్ దిస్ వర్స్ ఇస్ దట్ దెర్ ఆర్ ఫైవ్ టాప్ మోస్ట్ థింగ్స్ విచ్ వీ షుడ్ ఎయిమ్ ఫార్. వన్ ఇస్ ఆరాధ్య భగవాన్ వ్రజేశ తనయ, దట్ ఈస్ ద సుప్రీం వర్షిపబుల్ డేటీ ఇస్ కృష్ణ ఆఫ్ వృందావన్. తద్ధామ వృందావన, హయెస్ట్ సుప్రీం అబోర్డ్ ఇస్ వృందావన్. రమ్య కజిత్ ఉపాసన, దట్ ఈస్ ద హయెస్ట్ ఫార్మ్ ఆఫ్ వర్షిప్ ఇస్ దట్ డన్ బై ద గోపీస్. దట్ ఈస్ ది అల్టిమేట్. ద ఫార్మ్ ఆఫ్ వర్షిప్ ఆఫ్ ద గోపీస్ ఇస్ ది అల్టిమేట్. హౌఎవర్ వీ షుడ్ నాట్ ఇమిటేట్ ద గోపీస్, బట్ వీ షుడ్ ఫాలో ఇన్ దేర్ ఫుట్ స్టెప్స్, ఎస్పెషలీ యాజ్ రికమెండెడ్ బై ఆచార్య శ్రీల ప్రభుపాద్ అవర్ సీనియర్ సన్యాసీస్ ఇన్ ద మూవ్మెంట్. వీ షుడ్ ఫాలో ఇన్ ద ఫుట్ స్టెప్స్ ఆఫ్ ద గోపీస్ టు అచీవ్ దిట్ అల్టిమేట్ డెస్టినేషన్ అండ్ పర్ఫెక్ట్ ద లైఫ్. ప్రేమ పుమార్త మహాన్, ద గోల్ ఆఫ్ లైఫ్ ఈస్ టు డెవలప్ ప్యూర్ లవ్ ఆఫ్ గాడ్ హెడ్. లాస్ట్లీ శ్రీమద్ భాగవత్ ప్రమాణ అమలం, ద టాప్ మోస్ట్ అథారిటీ ఇస్ శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం. సో ఇట్ మే బి నోటెడ్ దట్ విదిన్ శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం ఆల్ ది అదర్ ఫోర్ పాయింట్స్ ఆర్ ఎంబెడెడ్ ఇన్ దిస్. సో వాట్ మహాప్రభు బ్రాట్ అవుట్ యాజ్ ఫైవ్ టాప్ మోస్ట్ థింగ్స్, దే ఆర్ ఆల్రెడీ కంటెయిన్డ్ విదిన్ శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం, అండ్ భాగవతం ఇట్ సెల్ఫ్ హీ హస్ గ్లోరిఫైడ్ యాజ్ ద టాప్ మోస్ట్ లిటరేచర్. రైట్? ఆమ్ ఐ గోయింగ్ టు ఫాస్ట్ ఆర్ దట్ ఓకే స్పీడ్? ఓకే, రైట్, థ్యాంక్ యూ. నౌ శ్రీమద్ భాగవతం ఇస్ Krishna himself. Is it possible that we could have this fan slightly lesser, please? So Srimad Bhagavatam is Krishna himself, who lives here when Krishna is no longer with us. Is there a disturbance because of? Oh, I see. Okay, then it's fine. Then it's fine. No issues. So by getting to know Srimad Bhagavatam, we can know Krishna directly, we can know him intimately. The more we know Srimad Bhagavatam, Prabhuji, it's okay. The more we know Krishna. Srimad Bhagavatam is described as the body of Krishna. The first two cantos represent the lotus feet of the Lord. The third and fourth cantos represent the thighs. Fifth canto is the navel, sixth canto is the chest, seventh and eighth are the arms, ninth canto is the throat, and the tenth canto is the face. What is Rasleela? What is Rasleela within the tenth canto? Yes, yes, you are right. It represents the smile of the Lord. 11th canto is the forehead, and 12th canto is the head. Now one time it so happened that Hanumat Prekshaka Maharaj, he was conducting a Bhagavatam class over a few days in one of the temples in US, and he was explaining this very point that, you know, you should know Krishna very, very intimately. So much so that if Krishna comes here, we should be able to recognize Krishna. So how will you recognize Krishna? And that is very important. So he said, first canto, how many chapters? They said, they could not answer. Okay, second canto, how many chapters? They were fumbling. Okay, first canto, what is the theme of first canto? Somebody said, Parikshit Maharaj meets Sukadev Goswami. I mean, where else could he meet? I mean, it was an obvious thing. Then Maharaj made a comment. that if Krishna comes here, you will not know the difference between his feet and the feet of a buffalo. That is what he was wanting to say. Look, you got to know Krishna personally, and Bhagavatam gives it. So please take advantage. So we should not take offense at what Maharaj said. It is just that he was trying to emphasize this point that we need to study Bhagavatam, as Prabhupada puts it, scrutinizingly. So in this way, we can have darshan of the entire body of Krishna. So this will ensure that unlike Duryodhan, who saw Krishna in the battlefield there, but did he recognize him? How many people, when Mahaprabhu came here, how many people recognized Mahaprabhu? Hardly anybody. We should not fall into that trap. That is why Bhagavatam. And that is the reason why Srila Prabhupada instituted this practice of reading Srimad Bhagavatam every day in all the temples as part of the morning program. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Right? Agreed? So Srimad Bhagavatam gives us an opportunity to get up close and personal with Sri Krishna. Details about who he is, what is his personality, and how can we interact with him personally, etc. Hence the contents of Srimad Bhagavatam are incomparable, as it signals right from the second verse of Canto 1 about its uniqueness. You can now project 112 on the board. It makes us a promise, and we can easily test its claim. Now, as I said before, this is a verse where Bhagavatam describes itself. Now, this is a spiritual text. You may be wondering, why should the Bhagavatam describe itself? Let us see a materialistic example. Suppose if I want to buy this mobile phone or this laptop. What do? I go to Amazon. And there, I see the description. And the description tells me that, yes, this laptop, Acer model, this thing. This is the hard drive. This is the speed of the processor. This is the RAM. Everything. It describes the product. We can see the reviews, etc., etc. Now, a materialistic thing can describe itself in that Amazon website. Why can't website? Bhagavatam. So, we'll read the verse 112, and you can recite after me. Dharma projita kaitavatra. Paramo nirmatsaranam satam. Vedyam vastavam astravastu. Shivadam tapatrayon mulanam. Srimad Bhagavatam Mahamuni Krite. Kimvaparair Ishvaraha. Sadhyo hridi avarudhyate tra kritibhi susrubhi takshanat. So the purport reads as, completely rejecting all religious activities which are materially motivated, this Bhagavata Purana propounds the highest truth, which is understandable by those devotees who are fully pure in heart. The highest truth is reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. Such truth uproots the threefold miseries This beautiful Bhagavatam compiled by the great sage Vyasadeva in his maturity is sufficient in itself for God realization. What is the need of any other scripture? As soon as one attentively and submissively hears the message of Bhagavatam, by this culture of knowledge, the Supreme Lord is established within his heart. I mean, we can't have a better description as to what Bhagavatam is and what is the phala of reading Bhagavatam. Everything is packed into just this one verse. The first verse, 111, described about the glories of the Supreme Lord. The second verse describes about the glories of Bhagavatam. Now we shall see this verse. All of you may have read and understood this verse earlier on, but just to make this point more emphatic, we will see a little more in detail. We will discuss this verse. Is that okay? The first thing, what the Bhagavatam says is, Kaitava religion, cheating religion, is thoroughly kicked out. We reject all cheating dharmas and cheating religion. Actually, religion is a false promise. We are all looking for unlimited and permanent happiness, and along comes a religion to cheat you. How? You want more money? Please give us a donation. You want a good house? Okay, you do this yajna. You bought a new car? You want that car? You want to run the car without accidents? Do a car puja. These are the kind of things, that is, ek haath de, dusri haath le. It is fondering the, sorry, it is sort of encouraging a barter mentality. No. And whom are you doing that with? The Supreme Lord, as far as his riches go, there is no words to describe. He is the most rich personality on the creation. And what are you doing? You are wanting some trinkets on the side. It is just like that old lady whose stack of sticks, they fell down on the ground. She called for Krishna. Krishna came. He said, what do? He said, put it on my head. This is just like that. Bhagavatam says, we are not doing this. Bhagavatam is very clear about this. Now we'll see this by way of I'll take a little bit of time just to explain all this so that, you know, it remains embedded in our hearts. We all are grahasthas, we are living in our houses. At one point in time, we'll be cleaning our house. Suddenly out from one corner, one cockroach is coming. That is representing Kaitava religion. So what do? We go to the place where we store the broom. We bring the broom and we bless that cockroach. We are Vaishnavas, at least aspiring. So we bless that cockroach. And we escort that cockroach right up to the doorstep. And udhar se we give it a kick. We eject it. This is what Bhagavatam will do to Kaitava religion. Okay? So if you read Bhagavatam, you will get this amazing broom with which you will be able to tame all those unlawful desires and thoroughly eject them from your heart. They will not get any space to flourish, those Kaitava religions. Bhagavatam, one pointed attention. We will come to that. This is the power of Bhagavatam. So anyone, again, within quotes, as told by Prabhupada, who scrutinizingly studies Bhagavatam will be endowed with this potency. He will be able to ascertain which is his duty and which is not. Like, I quoted this verse in the first class also. Again, we'll be looking at this verse, not in detail. Arjuna is standing on the battlefield. He is a friend of Krishna. Of course, he is devoted to Krishna. That is why when Duryodhan took Krishna's army, he was not very concerned. He said, I want Krishna. But he was on the friendship level. And then entire first chapter, he is narrating. And then in 2.7, he is having this final moment of breakdown. Karpanya dosopahata swabhava prichhami tvam dharma sammudit. He is having this final moment of breakdown. He is in illusion. He doesn't know what to do. He surrenders to Krishna. Or rather, he tells Krishna, you tell me what I have to do. Then Krishna takes him through Bhagavad Gita. He comes to 18.73. At that time, Jo Arjuna, who was in illusion, he hears Bhagavad Gita from Krishna. 18.73, he said, Nasta moha smithil lapta. My illusion is now gone. Arjuna said, my dear Krishna, O infallible one, my illusion is now gone. I have regained my memory by your mercy. I am now firm and free from doubt, and am prepared to act according to your instructions. So this is dharma projita kaitav. So this is what happens when you study scriptures like Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavata. Second point. Now, we all are familiar with IIT entrance exam. Anybody who passes class 12 is not automatically admitted into IIT. IIT is creme de la creme, top. So you need to qualify yourself to be able to get into IIT. Similarly, Bhagavatam is creme de la creme. You need to be qualified to enter Bhagavatam school. What is the qualification? Nirmat Saranam. Your heart should be non-envious. Krishna is enjoying with gopis, why can't I also enjoy? That mentality has to go. Our heart should be non-envious. So if your heart is not honest when you are starting to read Bhagavatam, you may read it like a storybook, nothing will go here, nor will anything remain here. And Bhagavatam also says, look, we will not cheat you, but you also should not come with a cheating mentality. Oi, barter mentality. Humne 2 rupya diya, kharcha diya, aur humko 1 lakh rupya ka kuch mil gaya. No, that is not admissible here. You have to invest your time. That is why Prabhupada says, Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. You will get the result. We just have to follow the directions of Srila Prabhupada and our spiritual masters. So this is the entrance exam for getting into the school of Bhagavatam. Now, we pass the entrance exam. Now we know, we do 5 years of IIT, you know what are the kind of jobs which are waiting for us. Or maybe we'll get into MBA. Right, from Goldman Sachs and those kind of companies, they'll come with few lakhs of rupees offers, etc. So we know, mera goal wo hai, 5 lakhs of rupees per month. So I do this 5 years IIT. Similarly, we have started Bhagavatam. What does it offer you? Vedyam Vastam. That is, it offers you something real. In the material world, what are we doing? We are running after unreal value. We are running after shadows. And all kinds of desires are keep propping up in our consciousness. those desires are either fostering our Nitya Dharma, or some of them are simply perpetrating our material existence if we keep cultivating them. So it gives us real things. It helps us to identify what is real. We will discuss what is that. Vedyam Vastavamastu. So whatever we are dealing in our material life is called Avastavamastu. That is, it is not a factual substance and we are attracted by shadows, which are unreal in nature. Whereas Vastavamastu is a substance which has real value, and that which is substantial and has originality. Jagannath ji, his devotees, spiritual world, Sangha. This is real. Everything else is illusion. This is what Bhagavatam gives us. And now, where does Bhagavad Gita leave us? Bhagavad Gita leaves us at Sarva Dharmam Parityajya. That is, it is an order. Give up all varieties of religion. That is the end. Because Krishna takes you through Karma Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Ashtanga Yoga, etc., etc. Then he says, give up all varieties of religion. That is where Bhagavad Gita sort of ends. Bhagavatam sam dharma projita kaitam. That is, now you have given up. You have been admitted into the school of Bhagavatam. Now you have given up. So this is where Bhagavad Gita ends. Bhagavatam starts. Now, Srila Prabhupada, last time also we saw as to why we should read Bhagavatam through personalities coming in our parampara. We saw that point. Otherwise, it has some Sanskrit meaning. If we study a little bit of Sanskrit, what is Bhagavatam intending to clarify to us? It will take us in a different meaning altogether. So that is why we have to follow our acharyas in our parampara. Prabhupada translates this as reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. That welfare of all is very necessary. Reality distinguished from illusion is knowledge. Let us take an example. Nuclear bomb. It is a knowledge. But when it falls on a place, is it for the welfare of anybody? No. This is where Prabhupada brings in that difference. So you can see how important it is to study Prabhupada's books. Reality distinguished from illusion for the welfare of all. And so nuclear bomb, is it Shivadam? No. Bhagavatam is Shivadam. That word Shivadam is there. Huh? Now, what is the effect of studying Shivadam? Bhagavatam? It will bestow auspiciousness, Shivadam. So not only will the miseries be eradicated, but the avidya will be uprooted right from its root. Avidya will be uprooted. So it removes the threefold miseries. Trapatraya unmulanam. This is what that removal of threefold miseries is. And what are the credentials of the author? He is Mahamuni. Yes, Vyasadeva, the literary incarnation of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now, can anyone beat him? He is a Supreme Personality of Godhead. Can anyone beat him in the art of writing? No. So he is Mahamuni. And when did he write Bhagavatam? He wrote Bhagavatam at the maturity of his writing career. So that learning curve he has gone through. You understand learning curve, I suppose. So he has gone through that learning curve of writing, and then he delivers Bhagavatam as instructed by Narad Muni. Because of all of this, Vedavyas asks, Kim va parair Ishvara? Why do we need any other literature? Do we need? Where you have all this packed within that, and still some more is coming. Do you need any other literature? Kim va parair Ishvara? And because we are rendering this susrusa seva, that is rendering service to Bhagavatam, what is the effect? Sadhyo hridaye avarudyate. That is, the Lord becomes captured in your heart as an irrevocable fact for that devotee who simply studies or serves Srimad Bhagavatam or the person Bhagavata. So this is the benefit. This is the phala. And lastly, how long does this process take? Million lifetimes? Million years? Tatshanat, immediately. He says, no million lifetimes, nothing. It starts immediately. So, what a powerful verse. What should we do? Follow the instructions of Prabhupada. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. So we can never go wrong. So if one reads Bhagavatam in the proper consciousness, then the Lord will manifest in the heart immediately. So right in the second verse, Bhagavatam presents its content. What makes it different and unique from other books? It presents the adhikara, the qualification of the reader. And it's very upfront about the fact that there is nothing wrong with the other scriptures. Actually, there is nothing wrong with the other scriptures. Actually, I cannot form part of this class because that's a class by itself. We can give a one-hour class and it will come, hopefully with your blessings, in the third glorification which is there, where Jiva Goswami glorifies in his Sandarbhas, which I am doing now. It will take some more time. I'm trying to study that. There it describes these kind of and contrasts it with, you know, materialistic philosophy and what Shankara and all the others have written, all that. So that aspect, we can just take it that yes, we agree with it. So there is nothing wrong with other scriptures, but this is special. How special is it? Now, have you all heard of a Cartier product? Has anybody heard of Cartier? I'll tell you what it is. It's a watch. Cartier watch. Now, that watch, I looked it up in Google. The blooming watch cost 3 lakhs of rupees. My watch cost 2,000 rupees. Now, if you want to buy a Cartier watch, you got to go to that kind of a showroom where possibly they will invite you to buy the watch and then only you can go and have a look at it. This one you will get in Big Bazaar and all of that. Bhagavatam is Cartier watch. So, we cannot look down on Bhagavatam that it is clarifying its product. It has every right to do so. Like all other scriptures, they also do so. So Bhagavatam also glorifies itself. So, this is the highest thing and we should not expect anything else. Right at the end of Srimad Bhagavatam, the last verse of Bhagavatam is 12.13.19. In 12.13.18, it is said, Srimad Bhagavatam Puranam Amalam Yad Vaishnavam Priyam. That is, Bhagavatam is the spotless Purana. It is most dear to the Vaishnavas because it describes the pure and supreme knowledge of the Paramahamsas. This Bhagavatam reveals the means for becoming free from all material work together with the processes of transcendental knowledge, renunciation and devotion. Anyone who seriously tries to understand Srimad Bhagavatam, who properly hears and chants it with devotion, becomes completely liberated. So now we can see Srimad Bhagavatam is the spotless Purana. It is the highest scripture imparting supreme knowledge of the Paramahamsas. There is a place for low quality products like this watch. You will get in all big bazaar and all kinds of nook and corner shops. But if you want a Cartier watch, you got to go to that shop. So if you want the highest goal of life, study Bhagavatam. Now, the next verse can be projected, 113 can be projected on the screen. Now we will discuss just one more aspect of the glories of Srimad Bhagavatam. What Bhagavatam is, karke we will be now looking at in depth. Nigamakalpa Taroor Galitam, that verse. Got it, Prabhu? So can we recite this verse? Nigamakalpa Taroor Galitam Phalam Sukha Mukha Amrita Dhrava Samyutam Pibhata Bhagavatam Rasamalayam Muhuraho Rasika Bhuvi Bhavukaha. So we are going to discuss about the Rasamalayam of Bhagavatam. Bhagavatam is compared to a ripened fruit. When the fruit is bitten by a parrot, the fruit becomes even more tastier. Srimad Bhagavatam was initially spoken by Vyasadeva to Sukadeva Goswami. And when Srimad Bhagavatam is spoken by Sukadeva Goswami, Bhagavatam becomes even more juicy. Two examples, we will see this. When Bhagavatam, Vyasadeva is speaking to Sukadeva Goswami, one aspect. Second aspect, Sukadeva Goswami is speaking to Parikshit Maharaj and everyone else. Two examples. We saw that yes, Bhagavatam becomes even more juicy. Now normally, who is the author of Srimad Bhagavatam? Vyasadeva. So he is supposed to be the authority in Bhagavatam. He has given it to Sukadeva Goswami. Sukadeva Goswami is sitting and narrating it to Parikshit Maharaj. Who is sitting there in that assembly? Vyasadeva. And not only Vyasadeva, Narad Muni is also sitting there. So how glorious is Bhagavatam when it comes out from the mouth of a devotee. So when pure devotees display their love and glories for the Supreme Lord, this display is even more sweeter than the glories themselves. Shall I repeat that? When the pure devotees display their love and glories for the Supreme Lord, this display is even more sweeter than the glories themselves. Hence, we see such exalted personalities hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. The second example, we all know that Krishna, when he was a young boy, he used to steal butter from the houses of gopis. For some reason, Mother Yashoda did not get to see this act of Krishna stealing the butter. Okay, he broke the butter and then did the Damodar pastime, that is okay. But the very act of stealing the butter and getting caught and all of that, that was witnessed by the gopis. And they thought, okay, let us go and share this with Mother Yashoda. So this was being narrated in Kurukshetra. And they told Subhadra, you stand outside, hey, Krishna and Balaram will come, don't allow him entry. You make him stand outside. We are just discussing Krishna's pastimes. Krishna and Balaram came. They wanted to go inside. Subhadra said, no entry. But standing there, they could hear what the gopis are speaking about Krishna and Balaram. And then what was the reaction? Jagannathji. Krishna and Balaram, they got so stupefied by hearing that recitation that their hands, etc., shrunk. So the gopis are narrating the pastimes of Krishna, but even more sweeter is the gopis' narration themselves. This is Bhagavatam. So now one more example about the sweetness of Bhagavatam can be compared to the ripened fruit in a jackfruit or a mango. One, it's fully ripe, it falls to the ground. And then what happens to the fruit? It breaks. Bhagavatam is a ripened fruit, it does not break. It goes from the Krishna branch to Brahma branch. Brahma branch to Narad Muni branch. Narad Muni branch to Vyasadev branch. Vyasadev branch to Sukadev Goswami. The sweetness is increasing. And then when Sukadev Goswami gives it, it is only sugar. It is only juice. Rasamalayam. So normally in a fruit, you will see a fruit has three things. A seed, pulp, and skin. Bhagavatam is only juice. No seed, no pulp, no skin. You can drink the rasa right from first verse. The amount of content which is packed in that 111 janmadi yasya yataha can be gauged by the fact that Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he gave a lecture on just that one verse for 3 months running. What is the amount of content in that? Isn't it rasa? You won't find this in anywhere else. That is why this is said, this is rasamalaya. Now we'll see about rasa. We all know the story of Ramayana. And the story of Ramayana was already in existence, everybody knew. So when Sukadeva Goswami was narrating this very story of Ramayana to Parikshit Maharaj, he starts off by saying that, yes, you know the story of Ramayana, but yet again I'm going to tell you that. And Parikshit Maharaj also shakes his head. Yes, yes, I know the story of Ramayana. Yes, but please tell me. So Sukadeva Goswami starts off. And the entire half of the lifetime of Lord Ramchandra, he covers in just 3 or 4 verses. 3-4 verses, half the lifetime of Lord Ramchandra is covered. Then he stops. And he takes 5 verses just to explain one point. And then again he starts off in his fast speed. And then again he stops. Where is the place where he stops in Bhagavatam? Where the rasa is flowing. The banishing of Lord Ramchandra to the forest, etc., is a political move. Sukadeva Goswami does not spend much time. But when Ramchandra is banished to the forest, how are the people of Ayodhya taking it? How is Mother Sita reacting to that? That is where he spends time. What is that? Rasa. This is what he wants to give us. He wants to give us the rasa. Similarly, when Lord Ramchandra comes back, the kidnapping of Mother Sita, again a political angle, he doesn't spend much of a time. But when Lord Ramchandra hears about the kidnapping of the thing, what is going through his mind. Or when Lord Ramchandra comes back, that Ram Bharat Mahamilan, that is where he spends time. This is Bhagavatam for you. Every time there is a viraha bhava in a relationship, he will spend time there to explain how the relationship is between the Lord and his devotee. This is exemplified in Bhagavatam. Viraha bhava is one of the trademark qualities of Bhagavatam, and which it puts it apart from other Puranas, which also tell the same story. Like for instance, the story of Vritrasura. You will find the story of Vritrasura in Ramayana, Mahabharata, Puranas, Itihasas, everywhere you will find. Who's the hero? No, 1 minute. In all the other places excepting Bhagavatam, it is Indra who killed Vritrasura, the demon. Who is the hero? In Bhagavatam, who is the hero? He is a demon, but yet he is the hero. Similarly, the Narasimhadeva pastime, it also occurs in other Puranas, etc. Who is the hero? Narasimhadeva. But in Bhagavatam, who is the hero? Similarly, the Bali Maharaj pastime, who is the hero? The Lord, Trivikrama. Three huge steps. Come to Bhagavatam. He is a demon. Right? So, what is being tried to emphasize here is that one could come from any background, but when it comes to the Lord and you exhibit a special relationship, these kind of relationships in the material world do not count. They go dharma projita kaitam. They don't stand this thing. Like for instance, children are supposed to obey the parents. In Bhagavatam, Prahlad Maharaj is teaching his father. Demons are supposed to be at a lower pedestal than devatas. But here, Vritrasura is being glorified. So when it comes to Lord, those sort of equations do not hold. Lastly, one point which will be very gratifying to Matajis. Wives are supposed to be subservient to husbands. But in Bhagavatam, it's exactly the reverse. When Krishna himself goes and those Brahmanas are performing the yajna, and he asks, Baba, humko bhook lagta, humko kuch do. Brahmanas are saying, no, we are busy doing feeding ahuhuti to the mouth of Krishna in the fire. They do not get. But when Krishna sends them to the wives feed them. And at the end, the Brahmanas are saying, fie on my knowledge, yaar. My wives have turned out to be my gurus. This is Bhagavat. Similarly, in the Raslila, where does Sukadeva Goswami spend most of his time? Moments of separation. This is Bhagavatam for you. So, that comes to the end. Of course, this is by no means, these are the only glories. No. There are plenty of other glorious acts. If Anantashesh, with his 10,000 mouths, he is glorifying the Supreme Lord eternally, he is not able to finish. We in 1 or 1.5 hours cannot do justice. So this is just a tip of the iceberg. But this is just to emphasize the importance of reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Thank you very much. So if you all have any questions, not that I claim to be a expert, I will try. Tell me.
Thank you so much for giving us
the sound. This is all Guru Maharaj's mercy. In fact, you remember I put this up last time. I'll read it once again. 3636. Maitreya's statement is that in order to avoid unchaste conscious activities, he was trying to describe the unlimited glories of the Lord, although he did not have the ability to describe them perfectly. This glorification of the Lord is not a product of research, but the result of hearing submissively from the authority of the spiritual master. It is not possible to repeat all that one has heard from his spiritual master, but one can narrate as far as possible by one's own honest endeavor. So it does not matter whether the Lord's glories are fully explained or not. One must attempt to engage one's bodily, mental and verbal activities in the transcendental glorification of the Lord. Otherwise, such activities will remain unchaste and impure. The existence of the conditioned soul can be purified only by the method of engaging the mind and speech in Jagannath's service. Thank you. Yes, Prabhuji, sorry.
Prabhuji, I was thinking Prabhupada told not to read Bhagavatam, but study Bhagavatam.
Yes.
What is the difference?
Yeah.
Then now I understand through you.
Not through me, through Guru Maharaj. I'm just trying to repeat whatever I've heard from various places. Like even Sridhar Swami, I read this comment out last time. Sridhar Swami compares himself to an amoeba, a small insect. And he is saying, where is this great ocean of Bhagavatam? How can I dive deep into it and find out the meanings which are, you know, within that? And how senior acharyas in our movement will churn the meanings or verses of Bhagavatam and take out all that what it has to offer. So we have to hear from Srila Prabhupada. He has taken a lot of effort to give us the scripture. We can only reciprocate by reading this submissively. Yes, Prabhupada. I have made the Vedya. Yeah.
Means I am to be known from the Vedas and I am known from
the Vedas. Yeah, I am the compiler of the Vedas. Yeah.
But being the straight incarnation of Krishna, Vedavyasa, how that mistake has happened, which was not right in the first attempt, and Narada had to come and correct him.
See, now, this is a question for which there is only one answer. He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He wanted to perform a leela and he wanted to glorify Parikshit Maharaj. All that, even Parikshit Maharaj, he was pretty learned. What was the need for him to put a dead snake onto that rishi? So all this is a pastime of the Lord. He brings in certain aspects at certain points in time. We, with our tiny brain, do not have the capacity to understand that. Of course, acharyas, they will be able to throw more light. But what comes to my mind is that, look, there will be certain times where we will not be able to understand what the Lord is wanting to convey. We just try to follow our spiritual master and Prabhupada. In due course of time, it will be revealed. So I will not know a definitive answer to be able to satisfy you. But what I do know is that, yes, I have to submit to Srila Prabhupada, maybe do some more reading. So if I do get that, maybe I'll share with you. Yes, Prabhuji. No, thing is, to be able to answer the second question, we need to compare ourselves with the people, general people on the street. We are definitely in the process of treading this path laid out by Srila Prabhupada, which is pure. Now, as far as the Madhavacharya point is concerned, I didn't quite get what you were trying to say, because I don't know whether Madhavacharya commented on that. I don't think so. Madhavacharya. Like, for instance, at various points in time, we decry what Shankaracharya had stated, that everything is illusion, practically saying impersonalist philosophy, that yes, it is only stagnated with Brahmajyoti. Now, all these personalities have been given a responsibility to bring in certain things, because if you see Shankaracharya's background, when did he come in? When Lord Buddha had established that, yes, you decry everything, including all the scriptures. So he just put one step forward. So it is all the pastime of the Lord. I mean, maybe the Acharyas would be able to give some more better insight into this aspect. But it is all the Lord wants, like for instance, Brahma Samhita. It's such a wonderful literature. We have only certain sections of it. So it may so happen that Krishna, as we progress, as we improve in our devotional life, he will reveal the other parts of Brahma Samhita also. Like he has revealed Mayapur. Mayapur was under deluge of water after Mahaprabhu left, Nityananda Prabhu left. Then it took Jagannath Das Babaji, who could not even walk. He had to be taken by Bhakti Vinod Thakur to that place, and then he jumped down from that wicker basket to say, yes, this is the birthplace of Mahaprabhu. So the Lord has his logic. We in our tiny brain have not yet come to that level that, yes, we will be able to grasp that. We have to persevere. And in due course of time, all these revelations will happen. Because this is what Krishna has promised. He only sees our endeavor. So I'm sorry, I may not be able to, I'm not answering your questions and just taking shelter under one this thing. But this is what comes to my mind, unless someone else can throw light on this particular aspect. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, Prabhu. Reading Bhagavatam is, we take the book Bhagavatam and read it just like a storybook. Storybook, what are we interested? We are interested how the hero kills the heroine or the demon, something like that. And we just skim the storybook. Maybe when, in fact, I will admit, when I was a school student, the James Hadley Chase and Arthur Haley, etc., we used to have competition, how fast I could read. That is skimming the surface. Whereas Bhagavatam, studying what, just like what Sridhar Swami says, is that firstly, our heart should be pure, and we should study Bhagavatam. Take one verse at a time, go deep down into it, See what various acharyas and authorities in our sampradaya have to say about that. Try to hear the lectures which our spiritual masters and other sannyasis in our movement have said about that particular verse. Make notes. And I'll be frank with you, this practice of making notes, it helps me, because what happens, you listen, iskan se uskan, gone. But you hear that same thing about two or three times. You absorb that. You should not be in a running race to finish, say, first canto in 10 months. No. You read maybe one chapter, but go deep down, which is what Sridhar Swami says, that that is when I will be able to extract the gems which are hidden in the verses of Bhagavatam. And you and me will not be able to bring out those gems. It is authorities like Prabhupada who are able to extract that. And the acharyas in our parampara, they will be able to extract that and give it to us. It is always better to study collectively. Individually, yes, we may be able to do it, but then, okay, you persevere, you will get the knowledge, because the Lord will see your perseverance endeavor and He will give it to you. But if you do it collectively, you will be on a fast track. I've seen that happening, that yes, especially people who are little more learned than us, who have studied Bhagavatam on a continuous basis for some time, we go under their shelter. It definitely helps. Like for instance, we went to Ahobilam, and I went with the devotees of Pune. There he brought the seventh canto. He took us to Prahlad Padi, where his school was. And he opened and he explained, you know, how Prahlad was preaching to all his demonic friends. He just read two or three verses there. And he explained in depth, like that. And in other places in Ahobilam also, we covered quite a lot of seventh canto. Like that, you will be able to do, or rather absorb this material when you are in the Sangha of senior Vaishnavas. At least I found that working for myself. Yes, Guruji. Shall we close? Because it's 10 o'clock. Srimad Bhagavatam Grantaraj ki jai, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Nitai Gaura Premanande Hari Hari Bol.